Okay, tonight is the 26th of July. This is the 11th night. We are talking on the Digha Nikaya Suttas. Tonight we come to Sutta number 16, Mahaparinibbana Sutta. Of all the suttas, the Buddha's, of all the suttas recorded, the longest is this one, Mahaparinibbana Sutta. And there are many incidents inside here mentioned concerning the last days of the Buddha. So it's not like other suttas where it's just one talk. This one is not. This one is many, many days. Thus have I heard. Once the Lord was staying at Rajagaha on the mountain called Vulture's Peak, Gijakuta. Now just then, King Ajatasattu, Videhiputta of Magadha, wanted to attack the Vajins. He said, I will strike the Vajins who are so powerful and strong. I will cut them off and destroy them. I will bring them to ruin and destruction. And King Ajatasattu said to his chief minister, the Brahmin Vasakara, Brahmin, go to the Blessed Lord, worship him with your head to his feet in my name. Ask if he is free from sickness or disease, if he is living at ease, vigorously and comfortably, and then say, Lord, King Ajatasattu Videhiputta of Magadha wishes to attack the Vajins and says, I will strike the Vajins who are so powerful and strong. I will cut them off and destroy them. I will bring them to ruin and destruction. And whatever the Lord declares to you, report that faithfully back to me, for Tathagatas never lie. Stop here for a moment. So you can see from here, this King Ajatasattu is a very ambitious king. He's not content with his own kingdom. He wants to seize the Vajin kingdom. And he's not sure whether he can succeed. So he wanted to know what the Buddha has to say. Very good, sir, said Vasakara. And having had the state carriages harnessed, he mounted one of them and drove in state from Rajagaha to Vulture's Peak, riding as far as the ground would allow, then continuing on foot to where the Lord was. He exchanged courtesies with the Lord, then sat down to one side and delivered the king's message. Now the Venerable Ananda was standing behind the Lord, fanning him. And the Lord said, Ananda, have you heard that the Vajins hold regular and frequent assemblies? And remember, Ananda said, I have heard, Lord, that they do. Ananda, as long as the Vajins hold regular and frequent assemblies, they may be expected to prosper and not decline. Have you heard that the Vajins meet in harmony, break up in harmony, and carry on their business in harmony? I have heard, Lord, that they do. Ananda, as long as the Vajins meet in harmony, break up in harmony, and carry on their business in harmony, they may be expected to prosper and not decline. Have you heard that the Vajins do not authorize what has not been authorized already, and do not abolish what has been authorized, but proceed according to what has been authorized by their ancient tradition? I have, Lord. Have you heard that they honor, respect, revere, and salute the elders among them, and consider them worth listening to? I have, Lord. That they do not forcibly abduct others' wives and daughters, and compel them to live with them. And again, remember Ananda said, I have, Lord. That they honor, respect, revere, and salute the Vajin shrines at home and abroad, not withdrawing the proper support made and given before. Again, remember Ananda said, yes, Lord. That proper provision is made for the safety of arahants, so that such arahants may come in future to live there, and those already there may dwell in comfort. I have, Lord. Ananda, so long as such proper provision is made, etc., the Vajins may be expected to prosper and not decline. So here, when the Buddha was asked whether this King Ajatasattu will succeed in conquering the Vajins, the Buddha indirectly gave the answer, whether they follow these conditions of harmony and unity la, and if they do then they will prosper la, and they cannot decline la. Then the Lord said to Brahmin Vasakara, once Brahmin, when I was at the Sarandada shrine in Vesali, I taught the Vajans these seven principles for preventing decline. And as long as they keep to these seven principles, as long as these principles remain in force, the Vajans may be expected to prosper and not decline. At this, Vasakara replied, Reverend Gotama, if the Vajans keep to even one of these principles, they may be expected to prosper and not decline, far less all seven. Certainly the Vajans will never be conquered by King Ajatasattu by force of arms, but only by means of propaganda and setting them against one another. And now, Reverend Gotama, may I depart. I am busy and have much to do. And the Buddha said, Brahmin, do as you think fit. Then Vasakara, rejoicing and delighted at the Lord's words, rose from his seat and departed. Soon after Vasakara had gone, the Lord said, Ananda, go to whatever monks there are round about Rajagaha and summon them to the assembly hall. Very good, Lord, said Ananda, and did so. Stop here for a moment. You see, during the Buddha's time, the monks who lived dependent on a particular town, like Rajagaha, they might be living in the hills, in the valleys, in the caves and all that. And around Rajagaha, there were several hills. Several hills are mentioned in the suttas. So in the Vinaya, if they all come to Rajagaha for their arms round, they are considered one Sangha. So the Sima is the boundary around that area where all the monks constitute one Sangha. So that is the real meaning of Sima, the boundary. But later monks, they want to exclude other monks. They start to shrink the Sima. Shrink until now they talk about Sima Hall. But in fact, there's no such thing as Sima Hall during the Buddha's time. During the Buddha's time, what is considered Sima Hall now was called Uposatagara. That means the hall where people do the Uposata, chant the precepts, and carry out ordination and all that. So the real name is Uposatagara. Nowadays, people keep talking about Sima Hall, Sima Hall. It's a wrong term to use. So that's the meaning of Sima. Very good, Lord, said Ananda, and did so. Then he came to the Lord, saluted him, stood to one side and said, Lord, the Sangha of monks is assembled. Now is the time for the Lord to do as he sees fit. Then the Lord rose from his seat, went to the assembly hall, sat down on the prepared seat and said, Monks, I will teach you seven things that are conducive to welfare. Listen, pay careful attention and I will speak. Yes, Lord, said the monks. And the Lord said, as long as the monks hold regular and frequent assemblies, they may be expected to prosper and not decline. As long as they meet in harmony, break up in harmony, and carry on their business in harmony, they may be expected to prosper and not decline. As long as they do not authorize what has not been authorized already, and do not abolish what has been authorized, but proceed according to what has been authorized by the rules of training. As long as they honor, respect, revere, and salute the elders of long standing, who are long ordained, fathers and leaders of the Sangha. As long as they do not fall prey to desires which arise in them and lead to rebirth. As long as they are devoted to forest lodgings. As long as they preserve their personal mindfulness so that in future the good among their companions will come to them, and those who have already come will feel at ease with them. So long as the monks hold to these seven things and are seen to do so, they may be expected to prosper and not decline. Stop here for a moment. So just now earlier we heard about the seven conditions for a particular community of people, a certain race, certain country, if they practice those seven conditions, they will prosper. Nobody can conquer them. Now the Buddha modifies the seven conditions for the Sangha of monks and enumerates these seven conditions. These seven conditions are very important. If any group of people, they want to prosper and not have this downfall or be conquered by others, then they should practice these seven conditions. I will tell you another seven things conducive to welfare. As long as the monks do not rejoice, delight and become absorbed in works, it's too much, working too much, in chattering, talking too much. I see some of you come here, supposed to practice the holy life. Some of you talk too much. Eating time, breakfast, you're talking. Lunch, you're talking. Outside, in the veranda, you're talking. As long as you do not rejoice, delight, and become absorbed in sleeping, in company, keeping too much company, in evil desires, in mixing and associating with evil friends, as long as they do not rest content with partial achievements, as long as the monks hold to these seven things and are seen to do so, they may be expected to prosper and not decline. I will tell you another seven things conducive to welfare. As long as monks continue with faith, with modesty, with fear of wrongdoing, with learning, with aroused vigor, with established mindfulness, with wisdom, so long they may be expected to prosper and not decline. I will tell you another seven things conducive to welfare. As long as monks develop the enlightenment factors of mindfulness, of investigation of Dhamma, of energy, of delight, tranquility, concentration, equanimity, so long they may be expected to prosper and not decline. I will tell you another seven things conducive to welfare. As long as the monks develop the perception of impermanence, of no self or non-self, of loathsomeness, of the danger of overcoming, of dispassion, cessation, they may be expected to prosper and not decline. So, as far as the Sangha is concerned, first Buddha said that they should meet regularly. And then when they meet, they should not quarrel with each other, but meet in harmony and end in harmony. And then do not change what has been authorized already. And then honor and respect the seniors, elders of long standing. And then do not fall prey to desires. And then devoted to forest lodgings, seclusion, which nowadays a lot of monks don't practice. Seclusion means staying in secluded places, away from the cities and towns. As long as they preserve their personal mindfulness, etc. So then another seven things. As long as they do not indulge too much in work, talking, sleeping, mixing with company, evil desires, associating with evil friends, content with their attainments, then they will prosper. As long as, another seven conditions, as long as they have faith, modesty, includes humility. A lot of people, when they are new to the monastery, they are modest, they are humble. Sometimes people stay in the monastery too long and they become arrogant. With fear of doing wrong, with learning, with aroused vigor, with mindfulness, with wisdom. And as long as they practice the seven enlightenment factors, they may prosper. As long as they develop the perception of impermanence, always aware that life is impermanent. Anything can happen to your body. Anything can happen to your life. Don't be too sure of yourself, of no self, of loathsomeness of the body, of the danger, danger can mean danger to life, danger to your whatever you are content with lah, all your property, etc. Dispassion, cessation, etc. Monks, I will tell you six things that are conducive to communal living. As long as monks, both in public and in private, show loving kindness to their fellows in acts of body, speech, and thought, share with their virtuous fellows whatever they receive as rightful gift, including the contents of their alms bowl, which they do not keep to themselves. Keep consistently, unbroken and unaltered, those rules of conduct that are spotless, leading to liberation, praised by the wise, unstained, and conducive to concentration, and persist therein with their fellows, both in public and in private. Continue in that noble view that leads to liberation, to the utter destruction of suffering, remaining in such awareness with their fellows, both in public and in private. As long as monks hold to these six things and are seen to do so, they may be expected to prosper and not decline. So here, when people live together, they should practice these few things. I find some people don't know how to practice loving kindness towards others in body, speech, and mind. Share whatever, this one is for monks, share whatever they receive with other monks. And then the sila, those rules of conduct to keep purely. And then the right view, to have that right view, so that you don't act wrongly. So these are the six things that are conducive to harmony, to communal living, living together. Everyone must practice these six things. And then the Lord, while staying at Vulture's Peak, gave a comprehensive discourse. This is morality, this is concentration, this is wisdom. Concentration, when imbued with morality, brings great fruit and profit. Wisdom, when imbued with concentration, brings great fruit and profit. The mind imbued with wisdom becomes completely free from the asavas, that is, from the asava of sensuality, of becoming, of false views, and of ignorance. And when the Lord had stayed at Rajagaha as long as he wished, he said to the Venerable Ananda, "Come, Ananda, let us go to Ambalatika." "Very good, Lord," said Ananda. And the Lord went there with a large company of monks. And the Lord stayed in the royal park at Ambalatika, and there he delivered a comprehensive discourse. This is morality, this is concentration, this is wisdom, etc. Having stayed at Ambalatika as long as he wished, the Lord said to Ananda, "Let us go to Nalanda." And they did so. At Nalanda, the Lord stayed at Pavarika's mango grove. Then the Venerable Sariputta came to see the Lord, saluted him and sat down to one side and said, "It is clear to me, Lord, that there never has been, will be, or is now another ascetic or Brahmin who is better or more enlightened than the Lord." And the Buddha said, "You have spoken boldly with a bull's voice, Sariputta. You have roared the lion's roar of certainty. How is this? Have all the Arahant Buddhas of the past appeared to you, and were the minds of all those lords open to you, so as to say, 'These lords were of such virtue, such was their teaching, such their wisdom, such their way, such their liberation'? No, Lord. And have you perceived all the Arahant Buddhas who will appear in the future? No, Lord. Well then, Sariputta, you know me as the Arahant Buddha. And do you know the Lord is of such virtue? Such is his teaching, such his wisdom, such his way, such his liberation. No, Lord. So, Sariputta, you do not have knowledge of the minds of the Buddhas of the past, the future, or the present. Thus, Sariputta, have you not spoken boldly with a bull's voice and roared the lion's roar of certainty with your declaration?" Stop here for a moment. So this is Venerable Sariputta. He has so much faith in our Buddha Gautama that he says there cannot be another Buddha better than our Buddha Gautama. So the Buddha asks him, "Do you have the psychic power to read the minds of the past Buddhas?" or of the future Buddhas or of my mind? And he said, no. Lord, the minds of the Arhant Buddhas of the past, future and present are not open to me, but I know the drift or the way of the Dhamma. Lord, it is as if there were a royal frontier city with mighty bastions and a mighty encircling wall in which was a single gate, at which was a gatekeeper, wise, skilled and clever, who kept out strangers and let in those he knew. And he, constantly patrolling and following along a path, might not see the joints and clefts in the bastion, even such as a cat might creep through. But whatever larger creatures entered or left the city, all must go through this very gate. And it seems to me, Lord, that the drift of the Dhamma is the same. All those Arahant Buddhas of the past attained to supreme enlightenment by abandoning the five hindrances, defilements of mind that weaken the understanding, having firmly established the four intense states of mindfulness in their minds, and realize the seven factors of enlightenment as they really are. All the Arahant Buddhas of the future will do likewise, and you, Lord, who are now the Arahant Sammasambuddha, have done the same. Stop here for a moment. So here, Venerable Sariputta is saying, whatever Buddhas of the past and the future, they all attain enlightenment, just like our Buddha Gautama, abandoning the five hindrances, having practiced four intense states of mindfulness, seven factors of enlightenment, etc. They cannot be better than our Buddha. At the most, they can just equal him since they practice the same thing. Then while staying at Nalanda in Pavarika's mango grove, the Lord gave a comprehensive discourse to the monks. This is morality, this is concentration, this is wisdom, etc. And having stayed at Nalanda as long as he wished, the Lord said to Ananda, let us go to Patalingama. And they did so. At Patalingama, they heard say, the Lord has arrived here. And the lay followers of Patalingama came to the Lord, saluted him, sat down to one side and said, may the Lord consent to stay at our rest house. And the Lord consented by silence. Understanding his consent, they rose from their seats, saluted the Lord, and passing him by to the right, went to the rest house and strewed the floor, prepared seats, provided a water pot and filled the oil lamp. Then they went to the Lord, saluted him, stood to one side and said, all is ready at the rest house, Lord. Now is the time to do as the Lord wishes. Then the Lord dressed, took his robe and bowl, and went with his monks to the rest house, where he washed his feet, went in and sat down facing east, with his back against the central pillar. And the monks, having washed their feet, went in and sat down with their backs to the west wall, facing east, and with the Lord sitting in front of them. And the lay followers of Patalingama, having washed their feet, went in and sat down with their backs to the east wall, facing west, and with the Lord before them. Stop here for a moment. So you see, the Buddha, when he sits, he likes to sit facing east. This is the Hindu and yoga tradition when these yogis, they meditate, they like to face east, where the sun rises. And I guess it's because the direction of rotation of the earth, you are facing east, it's like you are sitting in a car, facing the front. The car is moving, you're facing the front. It's more comfortable. Then the Lord addressed the lay followers of Patalingama. Householders, there are these five perils to one of bad morality or failure in morality. What are they? In the first place, he suffers great loss of property through neglecting his affairs. In the second place, he gets a bad reputation for immorality and misconduct. In the third place, whatever assembly he approaches, whether of Khatiyas, Brahmins, householders or ascetics, he does so diffidently and shyly. In the fourth place, he dies confused. In the fifth place, after death, at the breaking up of the body, he arises in an evil state, a bad fate, in suffering and hell. These are the five perils to one of bad morality. And householders, these, there are five advantages to one of good morality and of success in morality. What are they? In the first place, through careful attention to his affairs, he gains much wealth. In the second place, he gets a good reputation for morality and good conduct. In the third place, whatever assembly he approaches, whether of Khatiyas, Brahmins, householders, or ascetics, he does so with confidence and assurance. In the fourth place, he dies unconfused. In the fifth place, after death, at the breaking up of the body, he arises in a good place, a heavenly world. These are the five advantages to one of good morality and of success in morality. Then the Lord instructed, inspired, fired and delighted the lay followers of Patalikama with talk on Dhamma until far into the night. Then he dismissed them, saying, householders, the night is nearly over. Now it is time for you to do as you think fit. Very good, Lord, they said. And rising and saluting the Lord, they passed him by to the right and departed. And the Lord spent the remainder of the night in the rest house, left empty by their departure. Stop here for a moment. So you see, the Buddha, having attained enlightenment, he used to walk from place to place in India. And each place he went, he would teach the Dhamma so that people would understand. But you notice, like in Patalikama here, that night, he only talked about morality, the five advantages and disadvantages of practicing or not practicing sila, moral conduct. If a person does not have sila, practice moral conduct, then he will kill, steal, engage in sexual misconduct, lie and cheat. So if he does that, he will lose his wealth. For example, if a person spends his time drinking away, getting drunk all the time, or going out at night to all the joints to take drugs and all this, then he neglects his duties, so he will lose all his wealth. Secondly, you get a bad reputation. If somebody has bad morals, nobody wants to marry him. Nobody wants to do business with him also, because they know he cannot be trusted. If he drinks, if he gambles too much, etc. And then in the third place, because of not keeping his sila properly, he's shy to meet a lot of people. For example, if a person is a drug peddler, and then he knows he's doing something that he's not supposed to do, he doesn't like people to know, and he doesn't like to meet people. In the fourth place, he dies confused. When he's dying, the mind is very disturbed. Sila is very important. Don't practice sila, then we harm other living beings. And when we are dying, this guilty conscience will prick us. Those people that you, or those beings that you kill, animals and all that, you probably see them coming to you when you are dying. And then the fifth place, after dying, you get a bad rebirth for not keeping sila. Now at this time, Sunida and Vasakara, the Magadhan ministers, were building a fortress in Patalikama as a defense against the Vajjins. And at that time, a multitude of thousands of devas were taking up lodging at Patalikama. And in the parts where powerful devas settled, they caused the minds of the most powerful royal officials to pick those sites for their dwellings. And where middle and lower ranking devas settled, they caused the minds of royal officials of corresponding grade to pick those sites for their dwellings. And the Lord, with his divine eye surpassing that of humans, saw the thousands of devas taking up residence in Patalikama. And getting up at break of day, he said to the Venerable Ananda, "Ananda, who is building a fortress at Patalikama?" Ananda replied, "Lord, Sunida and Vasakara, the Magadhan ministers, are building a fortress against the Vajjins." And the Buddha said, "Ananda, just as if they had taken counsel with the 33 gods. Sunida and Vasakara are building a fortress at Patalikama. I have seen with my divine eye how thousands of devas were taking up lodging there. And then the Buddha explained where powerful devas settle, they cause powerful humans to go there also. Where middle-ranking devas settle, stay, they also cause middle-ranking humans to stay there. And low-ranking devas will cause low-ranking humans to stay together.